recap of something for the second seating. The seatings will be at 2 and at 3:30, and the sign-up sheets with information is downstairs. They're on the round table, closest to the middle room, and we'd appreciate everyone signing up. Thank you.
Since this is a holiday weekend and we're a little bit short of students, all the students, when they're released, are going to go up to the first, second, and third grade room, and they're going to enjoy a very nice story and have a lot of fun. I thank you. Yes, sir.
Good morning. Still plenty of opportunities to sign up to volunteer for our congregation in the service. Greeters, ushers, coffee hour. We appreciate any help you feel compelled to do. Thank you.
Yes, Mel.
Good morning. If anyone is looking for an opportunity to celebrate Martin Luther King's birthday, there is a breakfast at the Alpine Grove that's held every year. And it's really a wonderful event. The choir that sang in our church a couple of years ago actually sings at that breakfast. And I believe it starts at like 8:30-ish. You'd have to check the paper. But I'd encourage you to attend. It's a really great event, and it happens every year at Alpine Grove.
You have to make reservations? Or
no, you can just come at the door. They have a great buffet breakfast and wonderful music.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We're prepared to serve. This is in February, and I will probably keep talking to you about this. The United Church of Christ puts this on every year. This is the only book that we have, but it's going to be downstairs for you to look at. These are workshops this day, February 25th, from 8 to 4. You can go to different workshops that will teach on various subjects. And it's for lay leadership. And that means lay leadership is anyone, by the way, who's not ordained. So guess what that means? Everybody in this room. Okay? Except for me. So, the subjects they cover are spirituality and worship. And under there, they're doing things like Psalms, Word for the Journey. That would be a workshop. Or Lecture, Prayers, Move You. Church leadership. They're doing workshops on your Robert's Rules. I think you guys have that down. Renewing the church in a changing culture, I would encourage us to participate in. Seeking balance for clergy and their families. Caring communications when you're having a difficult conversation. Do we have any of those around here? meeting the needs of a small choir or no choir. Okay. Miscellaneous legal issues for the church. Unleashing spiritual gifts. Managing stress in the workplace. Christian education. Volunteer management for Christian education, Bible survival, worship center curriculum, youth missions trips, ritual stories and relationship, nurturing families, the basic of directing a Sunday school program, mindful and faithful eating, nurturing and the practice of stewardship in children. There's a whole bunch of those. Stewardship, best financial practices for churches, joyful giving, stewardship 101, capital campaign, best practices, generational giving, service and global missions resources, making a covenant to seek economic justice, priorities for a beloved community, caring ministries, one woman, two lives, life interrupted, pastoral care, it's not just for pastors, welcoming children with learning disabilities, an introduction to Stephen's ministry, one-to-one relationship building in church, marriage equality, New Hampshire homeless children. Now, if we go together as a group, which I'd like to see us do, it's $32 a person. That includes our breakfast and our lunch. It's in Pembroke, New Hampshire, which is closer to my way. So it would be nice for you to come to my side of the country. So I won't come here and join you for us to drive together. I will meet you there, since Pembroke Academy is about 15 minutes from my house. So this is a February 25th event, so we have all of this month to talk about it, we plan for it, it's something we would do together as a church. You don't have to be on a committee to go, you just have to have an interest in something. And I think this would be something we'd all benefit from. So I'd like you to, children aren't able to go because they don't have child care that I know of, unless they've changed. So this is put on by the United Church of Christ. And then I'll be looking for you for United Methodists and events that they have as well. That's something I'd like to see you participating in.
just wanted to reiterate, I've been to that Prepare to Serve. It is an absolutely wonderful conference. It's very spirit-filled. The start of the event is actually in worship, and they bring all different cultures with them. It is absolutely a wonderful experience, and I recommend anybody to go. It really is.
It's lots of fun. We sit together during worship, and my goal, depending on how many of us are coming, is that we take certain workshops and we make sure we have representation of Brookline in all of them so we can learn as much as we can and bring those resources back to see how they can help us move forward or help us in the places that we feel like we need some help. So be encouraged and see this as our day out together. And we'll have fun. Thank you.
Please join in extending the right hand to the
thank you. function every week faithfully, and those that are visiting us for the first time, we ask that you would pour out your blessing upon us. We thank you for children. You have blessed us with children, and we are so thankful. We thank you for the future pastor that will come to this place when you allow the connection to occur. We thank you for the transition team and the work that they have begun and the timeline that's coming up and all the participants, each and every one of us, as we move forward together. We thank you and see every problem as an opportunity to seek your face, to pray more, to trust you more, to love each other more, to forgive more. We thank you very much for sending Jesus to die on the cross for each and every one of us, to be raised on the third day, so that we would have access to relationship with you. We just thank you for all that you continue to do in us and through us and for us here in Brookline Community Church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I am going to ask, it's not in your bulletin, but I shared it with the deacons this morning. We're going to be allowing members of every committee to speak to you about our lives together. So it's sharing life together here in Brookline. And so this morning, you will hear from the CE before we, or from the superintendent of Sunday schools before we go to the children's moment.
Hi, good morning, everybody. You've probably heard me every Sunday. So I just wanted to say good morning and I'll tell you a little bit about what the children are doing and what we're trying to do with the children. Our lives every day are filled with choices, and sometimes it's not easy to decide the best one to do. Do we visit a sick friend, or do we take a break that we need really badly? Do we bring our child to Sunday school, or do we take an extra hour to sleep in the morning? Sometimes we avoid making choices because they involve change. We often worry about the choices our children are making and work hard to help them discern what is right and what is wrong. However, adults have their own discernment issues. From filling out our income tax forms to dealing with crises in our relationships, we also face difficult choices. The lessons the children are learning are going to help them reflect on places and people they can go to for guidance to discern paths to follow. The children have learned so far this year from Matthew 21 that actions speak louder than words. Two sons were asked to help their father in the field. One said no, because the right thing was to help and eventually help. The other one said, oh yeah, I'll help you, and then didn't help. The children learned that what they do is very important to God. Follow through on your good intentions are always important. Another parable from Matthew was a lesson on caring for God's vineyard. The lesson on remembering that the earth is not ours. It belongs to God, and we should care for it. Another parable they learned is about being called to God's banquet and making choices on who we should let come, and that God invites everyone to his banquet. There was also one about a king who had a big wedding banquet. This is the same banquet. And nobody showed up that was called. And the children were asked, are they going to go when they're called? Are they going to follow what God wants them to do? They learn about Paul writing a letter about being brave and gentle and loving and helpful as part of the way we should live. They learn about comfort and joy and anticipating of Jesus' birth, and Mark about the good news that Jesus was coming. As they learned their lessons and had fun with crafts and learned songs like, I think they all taught you, there was a Savior for all kind and Jesus was his name. They're also learning each week how to make good choices. The Sunday school teachers have been very, very helpful throughout the year, and we can't do it without them. The Bible lessons help them find places to make good choices from being good people, good Christians. Each week your children get, the children of the church get a bulletin, just like the one you have, only it's specific for their classroom. In it, it goes through all the things that they're going to do throughout the day. And at the end, it has a question that they know the answer to. And I really want you to think about, when you take the bulletin home, ask your child the question. Have the conversation. Show that you, they
they know the answer, but also that you can help them work through them too. We hope your children are having a lot of fun. We've added a bell choir. We've added an all play so the teachers can have some days where they don't have to come to Sunday school. We've added a couple of things to make things a lot of fun, but we hope they're also learning to make good choices as they go. So we thank you for supporting our Sunday school, and we really appreciate it.
Now it's time for the children's moment. Can the children come up, please? In church, right? One of those ways is through the children's moment. Now, there's a sign-up sheet downstairs that's awfully bare and empty. And I know a lot of people don't like to do children's moments because they're afraid of having to stand up in front of people, whatever. It's a really easy audience. Or they're concerned that they don't have materials. I have materials. I will leave this downstairs. It is filled with devotionals and object talks and children's sermons and other things. If you don't like that, I can give you great web pages. So think about signing up. Sheets downstairs. See me if you don't feel like signing up. We can work out a good day for you, and I can introduce you to some fun stuff. Okay. Now back to our previously scheduled children's story. I don't have enough toys. Could you grab some hymnals and pass them out in front? Because everybody needs something hard to write on.
Hard to write on. in the Hebrew Bible, right? What they do is, I'll make a sacrifice, that'll perfume it, God won't notice it, we'll cover it up, right? If you love us, no matter how hard, no matter how good your eraser is, no matter how hard you erase, nobody's got a clean piece of paper. There's always some little bit of oops left. And some people's erasers are better than other people's erasers. Some people's erasers just spread out the oops. Right? Yeah. There's no one piece of paper that's nice and clean. God has a solution for that. It's glorious. It's wonderful. It's a fabulous gift. And hey, it's January. We can still get gifts. That gift is Christ Jesus. Jesus is the only one whose eraser is good enough to get rid of the oops. Jesus is the only one that can give us a fresh, clean sheet of paper. For the low, low, low price, what's the low, low, low price? How do you get a fresh, clean sheet of paper?
Buy a big sheet from the store.
Buy a big sheet from the store? Well, yeah, I don't know. Just get one?
It does not like one song.
But one way that Jesus can give you your fresh clean sheet of paper, picture this is in your heart, right? You've made an oak, you've tried to get rid of the oak, you can't do it on your own. Because nobody can, no matter how good the erasers are.
I have two pieces of paper.
The only way to get a fresh, clean sheet is to ask Jesus. And he'll give you one for the low, low, low price of?
Zero.
Exactly. It's a low, low, low price of zero. All you have to do is go, excuse me, I made an oops. I'm really sorry for it. May I have a new sheet of paper, please? Lord, I made a mistake. I'm really sorry for it. I'm trying to fix it, but I couldn't get it right. Help me out. Help me make it better. And he will. And that's the gift, the precious, wonderful miracle. So we can bow our heads and have a little prayer, and then we'll go off and have Sunday school fun. Yes, it is fun. May you work in our lives. May your Son, Christ Jesus, come into our lives. Help us to erase those oops that we've made. And remind us to ask for it on occasion, because sometimes we get so busy trying to cover up our oopses that we forget that you're there to take them away. Amen. All right, have a Sunday school.
Responsive reading is on page 503 in your Pew Bible, and it is Psalm 139, 1 through 6. And I'll read the odd, and if you would read the even. So it's on page 503, and I'll read the odd, and if you could read the even. O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
When I sit down and when I rise up,
you discern my thoughts from far away. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely.
You hem me in behind and before and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is so high that I cannot attain it.
Thank
a concern. The good thing is it's healing on its own.
That's good.
Yeah, so that's improving. Mm-hmm. Just hope it doesn't return because they don't know what caused it, so they don't know how to fix it.
As much of as anything, it's an announcement, but we have new railings for the side door, courtesy of John Wideman. There's one problem this morning is that they're cold.
Any other joys this morning? Are you all here this morning? Yes. This is good. See? That's a joy. I'm here this morning. You have to say that. Turn to the person and say, I'm here this morning. Go ahead. Tell them. I'm here this morning. That's a joy. I'm here this morning. Concerns. First concern I want to lift up to you is Maribel, the seventh grader. She's at Children's Hospital. Her sickle cell is acting up, and she is at Children's Hospital this morning. So we are definitely going to pray for her this morning. Any other concerns? Do we have anything else we want to pray for this morning? Yes.
My granddaughter Grace is going to have eye surgery on Thursday to unblock her tear ducts.
Okay. Any other prayer concerns? Yes.
Pray for the finance committee and Russell and Bill, Ron and Bill.
Yep.
Trying to balance the budget.
And they will be sharing information with you next week during that sharing time. So we do need to pray for them. Any other concerns this morning? Yes.
We're going to pray or think about the children in really in the United States, but all over the world. Any child who is going to bed hungry.
Mm-hmm.
Any child who's going to bed hungry.
Yes. My husband's aunt had a stroke last week, but she's going to be going to rehab this week, so hopefully pray for her coming back from it.
All right, let us pray. Precious Lord, we do thank you and praise you for when we pray, you provide divine intervention. We thank you that when doctors are looking for things and they can't find it, and then there's this healing process that occurs and things seem to get better, everybody's questioning what the problem is, and in reality, you have responded to prayer. So we thank you for that. We thank you for safety and railings that have been provided for us this morning. We thank you for each and every one of us sitting in this sanctuary, and even those that want to be here but cannot for various reasons. We thank you for members of this congregation being part of our family. We also lift up our concerns. We lift up Maribel to you this morning, and we ask, Lord, that you would give the doctors wisdom, divine wisdom, and we ask, Lord, that there would be treatment that would relieve the challenges that she's facing, that you would help our parents to stay encouraged and hopeful, but most importantly, that you will give her the strength to endure whatever tests and things she has to go through. And we thank you for the privilege to be able to pray for her this morning. We thank you for those that are sick this morning, that you would bring them health, that they would find themselves back on their feet and continuing to do well. We thank you for those having surgery, that you would be in that operating room before they arrive, and that you would tend to the surgeons and provide them with all that they need so they can have a successful surgery. We praise and thank you for being with the children all over the world, but most importantly, right here in this state, New Hampshire. We have a lot of children tonight that will go to bed that have been hungry most of the day. Even though it's morning, they have not had breakfast, and they're not likely to have dinner or lunch, but they may eat something. And Lord, they will go to bed this evening hungry. They will not have access to school tomorrow where they can get access to free lunch. We ask that you, Lord, would use those of us that are aware and those of us who know families that are in those situations that would reach out and touch them. We ask that you would use people all over the state and all over the world to touch the children that are hungry, and that they would not go to bed hungry this evening. We praise and thank you also for our finance committee and ask that you would continually give them wisdom and that you would provide the divine intervention necessary for them to balance the budget, but most importantly, that you would bring it clearly to each and every one of us to understand our part in giving in the church. We praise and thank you that we have a finance committee that is committed to working out the details of what we need to do to successfully run the church. continue to lift up the concerns that continue to be about in this congregation. Concerns of the heart, concerns of how things run, concerns of change, all those concerns that sometimes can cause us to be in a state of grief. I continue to lift up those that are grieving, grieving over the loss of Pastor Smith, grieving over the loss of loved ones. Sometimes it takes busyness to slow down before we really realize how much we miss them, before we realize that we are still grieving. We experience fatigue, we experience anger, we experience blaming, we experience ourselves nitpicking and trying to find ways to find fault with things. It isn't necessarily because we're being difficult, but that we are in a state of grief, and grief is a real life entity that each and every one of us go through when we're experiencing loss. I ask that you would continue to bring healing to the Brookline Community Church with each member as they experience grief and loss over a pastor, grief and loss over friends, grief and loss over mothers and grandmothers and aunts and uncles and sisters and brothers, grief and loss over jobs, grief and loss over things that matter to them, health, time, that you would just continue, Lord, to comfort those who mourn. And we thank you and praise you for teaching us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we get ready to share with your offering, if you're new with us, you're not obligated to give unless it's something the Lord has placed on you because you've experienced something here. But giving is a part of worship. And yes, it does keep the lights on, but more importantly, it helps us take care of those who need the help. So as you give this morning, give with a cheerful heart and a grateful heart, knowing that you're giving because someone has given to you. Love all over this earth. In Jesus' name, amen.
lesson is from the New Testament. It's John chapter 1, verses 43-51, and it's on page 863 in your pew Bible. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now, Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered, "I saw you under the fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." And the next hymn is 653.
And you probably don't know this, and it's a really simple tune. And the verse is repetitive enough, I think it'll be okay. While you're finding it, it's "Make me a servant, humble and meek, Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant, make me a servant today." And he also, if you're not aware, he graduated from right thing to do. You look at the times where he was constantly in danger. And then you look at the disciples. Jesus walks up to people and says, follow me. He doesn't go up, he doesn't have a committee meeting with everyone and say, now in 2 weeks, I'm going to come up to you in public and I'm going to say, follow me. Jesus does his call as God did this call on Samuel's life. Samuel's mother, Hannah, had prayed and prayed and prayed for children. And she was struggling because she couldn't seem to get pregnant to have children. Women would go to the temple to pray once a year. They could go up to worship. And so when she's there praying, because she's talking out loud, Eli thinks she's drunk. He criticizes her and he chastises her for being drunk. And she's really just praying to God by speaking. Have you ever, you're just talking to God and your mouth is going, but nobody can hear anything come out of your mouth and they all think you're crazy? Does anybody here do that? No? Or have you ever been just talking to yourself at church, but you're talking to yourself and nothing's coming out of your mouth, and then all of a sudden it dawns on you that you're standing in the middle of the shower, standing there having a conversation with yourself, but nothing's coming out? Have you ever done that? Good, because I know I've done that. Or you're driving down the road, and you notice people are driving down the road, and they're just the same, and their hands are going and everything, and you wonder whether or not they're paying attention. Eli had this amazing response to Hannah. He thought she was drunk. She was pleading with God, pleading to give her a child. So when Eli realizes that she's not really drunk, he tells her, he prophesies for her, but that she's going to be pregnant. Now she does have Samuel, but in her pleading with God, she promised God she'd give the child back if God would just let her have a child. So when Samuel was born, she took him to the temple to give to Eli when he was weaned. In the Old Testament, women nursed their children till they were three. So now I want you to all think about walking to the temple with your little three-year-old to take it to the prophet, who you probably know has not been a very good parent himself. If you follow Eli at all, you know Eli was a terrible father, and he was a glutton. He wanted everything. He died falling backwards in a chair. His sons were not good. Yet God calls Hannah to bring her child because she promised that's what she was going to do. Anybody ever promised God you're going to do something, and then when you found out how hard it was going to be, how cold it was going to be, how embarrassing it was going to be, how much it was going to cost, you said, well, maybe I didn't really mean that. Anybody ever had that experience? Anybody had the experience? I had a friend who used to sing this song, please don't send me to Africa, Lord. I'll go anywhere you want, but please don't send me to Africa. Anybody here say to God, you can call me. I will do whatever you ask for. Please don't ask me to go do that. You see, the disciples don't know that Jesus can see in their hearts, and he knows that they're ready to be called. Here in Brookline, as you go through this transition, you see it as it's going to take too much time. You need to look at your history, which you'll be able to see with the timeline. You waited 3.5 years for Reverend Smith. In an interim where you weren't getting ready for his coming. You just went along as things go. But this time, God has put you in a place where he knows inside of you as a body what his heart and plan is for you 15, 20 years from now. And he wants to call you as a body of Christ in Brookline. Call you to follow after him. Following him means doing things like a Hannah, taking a three-year-old up to Eli and just going up once a year and bringing little Samuel all of his clothes and everything. Now, in the American culture, there's no way in the world a three-year-old would go up to some church and, because the pastor's in, they lived in the synagogue. They stayed at the temple. But no three-year-old in American culture is going to let you walk him up a hill and say, I'm going to leave you here with Mr. John. And Mr. John's going to take care of you. Mama will be back next year. Okay? I don't know what American three-year-old that would go, okay, Mommy, I'll see you next year. In reality, you see, she was trusting God that even though Eli was a terrible parent, that God would parent her son. She ended up having five children later. This was a woman who struggled with barrenness. I look at the disciples. Jesus called them. They're all trying to figure out, how do you know who I am? And Jesus says, well, you know, I knew you sitting under the fig tree. And then, you know, they're all thinking to themselves, I didn't see him anywhere. How did he know me? Now, we know when we were kids, things have changed a little bit. Remember when you were a kid, if somebody saw you doing something on the same street, they got after you and then they went and told your mother, and then you got in more trouble because the person down the street had to speak to you? Anybody ever had that happen to them? See, in our culture now, we don't all do that. If you see somebody's kid doing something, you go out and say something, the parents are going to come yell at you because you yelled at their kid. But a long time ago, it wasn't like that. You could be disciplined by anybody on the street. And your mother could convince you that she had eyes in the back of her head. I still got my kids convinced that I got eyes in the back of my head. So that when new people come into the house, they always say to them, she has eyes in the back of her head. Whereas my 22-year-old was reminding some of the kids, one of my sayings is, I've been doing this longer than you've been alive. and they repeat it. The point is that Jesus had been in existence and looking at the hearts of God's people longer than we, and they had been alive. And he knows us so well and so intimately. And he will recall, because sometimes, have you ever done this? Got off the beaten path, the things you said you were going to do? Which is why here in America always say it's January, and I'm going to make a new resolution. You know, my resolution is, you know, I'm going to stop drinking 4 or 5 cups of coffee a day. I'm going to give up my gummy bears. I'm not going to go spend that money on this. I'm not going to drive over the speed limit. I'm going to exercise more. I'm going to be kind more. What are some more that some of you have made resolutions for? Any resolutions out there? You don't want to tell anybody, do you? The point is that when we make resolutions like that to God, God, you just, this one time, just help me. I promise I'll do that. What happens is that life comes in, and before we know it, we push that aside. And just like you heard with the children's story this morning, that oops sometimes will lead us to believe. I was talking to a young man that we've been doing respite for, and you know, he's just getting into more trouble and more trouble. And I said, don't you remember what it felt like the day you asked Jesus in your heart? And he said, yeah, I do. He said, but I just keep messing up. I said, you know what? He loves you even when you keep messing up. But what you're doing is you're convincing yourself that you're such a mess up that God doesn't love you, so you keep messing up. I said, try it the other way. I messed up, God. Please help me. So when the disciples get called, they get called to walk with Jesus for 3 years. And if you go and look at the story, you'll see that what happens is that when Jesus gets arrested, they scatter and run for their lives. Why? Because they didn't forget what he told them for 3 years. I'll die with you, they said. Other people said, I'll die with you. I'm going to fight. I'm going to do this. And what happens? That's what happens to us as a body of believers, as a church. That's why it's so important for us to love one another, encourage one another, and know that God loves us. Because the natural thing that happens when it starts to get tough is to start blaming each other. And so even with Martin, when he finally makes his decision about what he's going to do, that God has called him away from the pulpit. Mm-hmm. He calls him away from the pulpit. He's been called to the pulpit, took over at his father's church. He gets called away from that pulpit, and God calls him where? Into the public light. Mm-hmm. Where his personal life becomes public. Everything about him is public. Did you know that when you decide as a church that you want to be for God, you will be in the public eye? What do you want 20 years ago, 20 years from now, for somebody to look back and say that Brookline Community Church was about? What do you want somebody to see 20 years from now? Do you think that Martin Luther King knew after he died that we would be celebrating his birthday every year? Do you think that he had any idea when he was a young man that he was going to impact social justice the way he did? Of course not. Do you think Samuel knew what he was going to be used by God when he was just a little boy? No, he did not. What is the similarity between Samuel and Martin Luther King? They said yes. They said yes when the call came. Yes. Not, I'm not really trained. I'm just a kid. I'm too tired. I'm too old. I'm too bad. I'm not very smart. I'm too busy. All they did was say, yes. And for each time they said yes, they prepared a way for you and I to know what it's like to respond to the yes. Martin had been stabbed by a black woman when he was striving to get the rights of people of color in our country. Martin was spending a lot of time ruffling feathers, making people angry for what was best for the future. Samuel becomes our last judge. Same thing, ruffling feathers. God is recalling you not to just be what you've always been, to be satisfied with the way it's always been. He's calling you to something new, just like when he called the disciples. He didn't call them to just be the fishermen they'd always been. He promised them that he would make them fishermen of people, fishers of people, not just that they would go out as they always had. He doesn't want you to be a church that's comfortable, just always trying to figure out how are you going to get the money for stuff. He wants you excited about your relationship with him and each other. He wants you excited about the love you've been entrusted to share with the community of Brookline. In simplicity, not in large, expensive way, but simplicity that each and every one of you in here matter to God. He's calling you because you're precious. And he wants you to help others hear that call. You're precious. And he wants you to come to him just like when we take our children because they're precious. You could be 85, you could be 90, you could be 2 days, and he still calls. He calls children, he calls adults, he calls seniors, he calls teenagers. He calls. Right here in this town, in this place. When you look at your history, you'll see where he's called you before. And he's not asking you to repeat history. He's asking you to work with him to make new history. So that 20 years from now, when this church is looking for a pastor, they will look back and say, this is what they've done for 20 years. How can we do better? It's not acceptable to be the same as we were yesterday when we're given a new day every day. I make mistakes all day long. That doesn't mean the next day I'm going to be content with just repeat yesterday. How about you? Because see, my new day says God's mercies are new every morning. And that means when I get up this morning, this is the only day I have. Yesterday's gone and tomorrow's in God's hands. And a string of todays will create a history of who God is in me and who God is in you. As he calls you, just like he called the disciples. He calls you to say, come love the world with me. Come feed the hungry children of New Hampshire with me. Come open your home to the homeless with me. Come and care for the sick
knows what you're going to go through as we go through this interim together. He knows already, and he still says, come with me. And he's not calling you to do the same. That's why Martin could step away from the pulpit and to be called to represent people who were oppressed, not just black people, but any people. That's why he was able to win the Nobel Peace Prize, because he was always about representing God in the presence of oppression and hopelessness. He says, come with me. I put that piece in there that I want you to read when you get home about how he looks at where do we go from here. Because I want you to see that in the context of the Brookline Community Church. When Martin was writing that, he was looking at African Americans of that time who had been brought here as slaves, who were slaves, and generations of slave after slave after slave. And so they had become, even though they were upset about being slaves, they had come to accept that was what it was going to be. And therefore, during that time in history, people of color did not have a full vote to go vote in the election. They were counted as one half a voter. Every person of color that voted in our country during that time in the South represented a half a vote. So it took two people of color to get a full vote. And the first thing he addresses is that you have to change the way you think when you're trying to get from here to there. As long as you keep thinking the same way, you won't change in the process. And I put that there not so you can all feel bad, but for you to look at. When you try to change something, the first thing you have to do to change is change the way you think. You got to hang around people who are going to keep you accountable to changing the way you think. God is calling you, Brookline. He's calling you today to allow him to help you change some of the way you think. Not because what you're thinking is bad, but because he wants to carry you into the future doing something more than what you've already been doing. And it means you have to be open. And if you read it, you'll see Martin was very clear. You have to know, honestly, where you are at the time you're trying to make change. And that's why your transition team is doing your history with you. Because if you don't understand where you are, if you don't know you're here and you want to get there, you have to have a starting point. Anybody out there drive without knowing where they're going? Don't you have to get in the car in your driveway? If you drive where you're going and you don't know where you're going? Oh, my Lord. We drove to Boston last night because they take my Haitian son. He was trying to convince me he could take a bus, but he's grounded, so he ain't getting on a bus to go to Boston. And he's trying to convince me I get on a bus, I can just go down there where my friend is, I can give him the key to the car. No, I said, that's not the way it works. Yeah, but I'll be back. No, you won't. That's why you're not going. We all got in the car, we drove to Boston. He's got a GPS. Well, I don't know where we're going. I don't know how to get to my friend's house. We always go by bus, okay? We've got the GPS, sometimes it works, sometimes it don't. And he thinks all he has to do is wait until we get to the turn and say, you turn right here. In Boston? I said, then you better tell me the directions before we get to the corner where we're turning. Oh, that's what God is saying. You gotta know where you are in order to know where you're headed. That's what he's doing right now for you. He's calling you and I to accept transition as a way of life. How many of you have had changes at your jobs? Come on. Did they ask you for permission to change things at your job? No. Are they comforting you or providing you with support while you go through the change? How many of you have had to go through the change of moving from one grade to the next? What grade are you in? Yep, what grade are you in? 10th grade. So last year or 9th grade. What grade are you in? 9th. What grade are you in? What grade are you in? You're in 7th grade. So you used to be in 1st grade last year. Wasn't it fun in 1st grade? It was. But she said she can't do 1st grade every year for the rest of her life. You see how transition works? It's a scary thing, but it shouldn't be. So this morning, my beloved, God is calling you again. Will you say yes to him? Allow him to use you as he walks you through the transition to prepare for what he's got in store for you. And we do it together, just like he did for Martin, just like he did for Sam, and just like Jesus did when he called the disciples. He's here this morning. precious beyond comprehension. Precious. Not because you're in church, because you were created in His image. He loves you. And He just wants to use you to love the world so they will know how precious they are. But now is your opportunity. What's your response to Jesus calling you again? If you don't know this song, we're going to do Take My Life, but the other song I wanted to share with you is that song right there. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. I want you to think about throughout this week that softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling you. That's what He's doing. Call. What's your answer? Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. About His business as we prepare for the future. In Jesus' name, amen.